This interview was recorded in October 2019.
Stephen, welcome.
Thank you.
It's good to sit down with you. There's a lot of people in the athletics community in Scotland who will have met you either during your previous time up in Scotland between 2012 and 2014 or since you've been back with us. But we thought it would be good to sit down and perhaps take a bit of a scenic detour here and chat about some of the things that you did before you came here and some of the things that have fed into making you the kind of coach that you are and the kind of team leader,
yeah,
the kind of director of performance and coaching that you are. So we're going to talk about a few things that might seem slightly unrelated, but hopefully it's going to all come together and we'll hear a bit more about
it's
your
an interesting
kind of
story.
Philosophy. It certainly is. So, well, we'll start at the beginning, I think, and I know that originally you were an athlete yourself. Unfortunately, not for as long as you would have liked, I think. But tell us a wee bit about your athletics career as an athlete.
Yeah, I probably started later than most people and finished earlier than lots as well. I was kind of a pain in the backside at school, where I was good at most sports, but not brilliant, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So it was. I'm just sports mad, so I love playing football, love Gaelic football, cricket, rugby, athletics. I was a good footballer, but not good enough, and a good Gaelic player, but not good enough, and I was fast, but not fast enough, and I was a long jumper and didn't jump far enough, and triple jumper and stuff like that, but I loved participation. I competed for Ireland, I was lucky, and I competed Schools International. Actually, my first ever international was the Schools International. SIAB, I think, is its most commonly known in Scotland. And believe it or not, Grangemouth was my first place that I competed. So, and brings back all sorts of memories every time I go into Grangemouth. And good memories, it wasn't great. But I remember the day I was competing long jump and triple jumper, and I think I've got his name right, Hugh Davidson from Scotland actually won the competition. And I looked at Hugh Davidson as going, bloody hell, he's good. And so my first international experience was actually in Scotland. So,
and I know you started fairly young as a coach as well.
I was coaching probably even at that age. I was certainly coaching at 16, 17, 18 and starting to. I was always intrigued about how people performed and how people did well. And, you know, without knowing a whole lot about it, I knew there was much more than just the physical end of things. I knew there was much more than just, you know, that you had to be physically fit and sort of strong and fast. I knew there was sort of headspace that needed to be worked at, but I didn't know what it was. But I was intrigued how it all fitted together, even at that age, yeah.
And coaching people at a reasonably high level at quite a young age.
Yeah, Irish champion. I think, I coached an Irish senior international and champion. I was only 19, 20 or something like that, so. But I was always coaching people in the club anyway, you know, whether, you know, and again, you know, always struggle with the word coaching. Is it coaching? Is it helping? Is it facilitation? Is it whatever, you know? And I was very lucky that, you know, in my early days, even before that, that we had some very good athletes in the club that I was in, Strabane Athletic Club, and two people in particular, a guy called Mickey Joe Doherty and another guy called Joe McColgan, who I would have learnt a lot from and who were avid readers even at that stage of Athletics Weekly, for example. And, you know, that was our sort of way of knowing what good was and reading the articles, understanding what performance was. And, you know, the guy who led the club, a guy called Jerry McDonald, and my father got involved as chairman to really drive the club through in very difficult times at that stage through the troubles and that. But we had a great time. But I learned a lot from those sort of people and learned a lot about coaching. And then once I got into sort of more of a national type thing, then you were picking up lots and chatting to lots. I've always talked to people, as I'm sure you wouldn't be surprised.
I don't think anyone who's met you would be surprised to know that. No, but your career as an athlete, unfortunately, was cut fairly short by injury.
Yeah, injury and probably the start of, you know, the early days of an illness type thing, autoimmune stuff that was going on in my body that I wasn't aware of at the time. So I would have picked up some sort of serious enough injuries at 17, 18 and that. And, you know, I didn't really have a junior career. And I had a couple of years then of out of the sport and then tried to get back. But I was always pulling my hamstring. I was always doing something. And, you know, I think I said it to someone else. I pulled a hamstring one time, sneezed. And, you know, I was stretching, but I sneezed and pulled my hamstring. So It was start of a lot at that stage. I was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis in my early 20s, and I was only just married, 24, 25, something like that, and trying to get my head around how my body was feeling all the time. And you know, and I knew that I was a decent athlete, but I could never get to a level of fitness and sustain a level of fitness that it would transfer into competition or even transfer into being the best that it could be and stuff. And I know that, you know, again, the two guys that I mentioned, Joe and Mickey Joe, both similar type things, you know. And sometimes I would ask myself questions, was it maybe not knowing enough early days, where we're overtraining, was I overtraining, was I doing too much, or was it just unlucky? And I think I was probably just unlucky, you know. And I think there was a, you know, there's an illness in around there that sort of didn't help things, but and certainly the diagnosis of what I had didn't help things, but the body just kept breaking down. And but then, you know, we didn't know really, I didn't know how to, you know, proportion training properly and do the right things at the right time, and it was just overload. And I'm that type of person as well, where I'm just all or nothing, you know, in everything that I do. So I just threw my whole life into training and bounding and plyometrics and lifting weights and sprinting hard and in the hills in the wintertime and all that, so I did too much.
And given the fact that you had rheumatoid arthritis coming on, presumably that was probably the worst thing you could have done in the
Yeah, absolutely the worst thing. And then it, as that has manifested itself into a whole sort of different type thing. So I'm a type 1 diabetic, and I was autoimmune type stuff and everything they got. So there's a whole big family of autoimmune things that was going on in my body that I had no idea.
And that escalated, I think, through your 20s. So you went from being very active to the point where not only were you not doing sport, but you weren't doing very much of anything, really.
Absolutely, doing nothing. Periods of time where I was just sitting at home, and you know, I had to take a considerable amount of time off work to the extent that I wasn't able to work. And Georgina, my wife, was the sort of the breadwinner in the house, as it's called. And so that was hard to take, and it was hard to take mentally as well, is that you just couldn't figure out what was going on. You couldn't figure out, you know, why. So I was going from this person who was trying to figure out how to be the best that you could be in an athletic sense, and how the body worked and how the mind worked, to then not being able to do anything myself, and then trying to figure out what the hell's going on, and why is my body not working at all then. And I was always an avid reader and an avid trying to get information and try and understand and try and figure out why and everything. Why do people run fast? Why do people jump long? And to the extent then was, why did my body break down? Why did I have this? And how am I going to cope?
So that's the same curiosity in a way that you'd already developed at an early age, watching other athletes and yourself wondering how this all works. And presumably, I think you've mentioned that you realised from an early age that there's a kind of element of the mentality and the psychology that goes into helping people achieve things, as well as the physical side of it. You took both of those into your approach to your own illness then, by the sound of it.
Yeah, and it was, you know, I remember, and you know, a guy who was a huge influence in me and who I learned so much, a guy called Mark Doughty. We did a course in arthritis care. I got in contact with arthritis care and tried to figure out what was going on, but it was a personal development course, and it was trying to understand, you know, what was going on. It was more psychological than anything, you know. And I hated the term, you know, I was with people, you know, it was a disabled charity. It was arthritis care, and it was disability. And even to this day, you know, I find it hard, you know, had I a disability, have I a disability, what is a disability? And at that time, you know, I wasn't able to do anything, was the way I sort of think. So I would never admit that I was sick. I would never admit that there was anything wrong, which, bloody hell, it was one of the worst things that you could do, and you just kept pushing. But that's me in my whole life. I push myself to understand and try and figure things out. And at that stage, that's what I was doing. I was discovering things and trying to figure out, why has all this failed?
And there must have been, or were there, specific things that you found out in that process that helped you come out from that period of really acute illness, and that also you've continued to find useful since then?
Yeah, and it's discovery, and I started figuring out then, you know, about pain management and about reading things, and, you know, I discovered, you know, the inner game stuff that's formulated my whole philosophy on coaching, and it was the inner game of work, the inner game
of... And what do you mean by that, the inner
game? The inner game is just, you know, it's basically about being present and about be understanding of what the here and now is and what you can affect and what you can't affect. And, you know, and it's very much a model that I love to work with in coaching. And at that stage I was introduced to the GROW model of goals, reality, options, and how do you sort it all out and things. And, you know, I discovered lots of really good people, you know, John Kabat-Zinn and people like that, and how they look at life and how you look at how things work and keep things fresh and mindfulness and
that. Mindfulness has become one of these buzzwords that, you know, people are trying to sell magazines and coloring books, and everything is mindful. But you mentioned John Kabat-Zinn, who was one of the originators of using what were traditionally Buddhist techniques and applying them to, in a secular context, to things like pain control.
Absolutely.
And depression and
Mark,
anxiety.
And Mark, who was doing this course, was a Buddhist.
Yeah, right.
And that's who introduced me to stuff. And a whole range of books and a whole range of Cherry Huber and people like that, and keeping things simple and life simple and very much keeping in the present and the here and now, and which is kind of how I coach and what my philosophy would be. And I think there's a massive link, through arthritis, you know, to discover things. I went and got involved with arthritis care, ended up on the board of arthritis care, ended up in finance and risk committees, and threw myself into it. But it was all about discovering what was going on with me. And it was all a discovery about, you know, what made me tick and what my acceptance levels were and things like that, and is that understanding. But it's interesting then that, you know, that I brought that into working with Mark and doing some things with Mark, and certainly lots of discussions with him around work and work within the disability sector and work within return to work for people who had been off work for a considerable amount of time, and mentoring and facilitation. So I started developing all those skills and understanding all those skills and understanding how to help people. But most of it was helping to understand myself. And I eventually then got back into sport again through accident, really. And just, you know, somebody asked me, can I help them? Their coach had died, and it was, you know, Shauna Carlin, who was one of the first athletes that started coaching, and Sharon Foley, who was an Irish international as well. Both of them were training, and they asked for a bit of help, and then I just inherited other athletes. And
so was that, while you were looking at this sort of coaching with arthritis care developing people in that sphere, were you thinking in the back of your mind, this is interesting, this could apply in sport? Or
totally.
Was that a complete surprise when you started coaching again, you thought, oh, actually? Or were you aware while you were learning
it was actually people within sort of, I was very lucky that I got sponsored to do, you know, like a master's program in coaching and personal development, so I was meeting a lot of people in business as well, and they were using sporting analogies, and I was thinking, bloody hell, that was me, you know. And you know, so I felt as if I had an awful lot to give within that sort of environment and that forum that I was meeting people in, that they were, you know, top business people, and I was using, you know, simple goal setting exercises and, you know, how you would prepare for sport. And I never competed at that high a level or whatever. As I said, I was an Irish international, okay, but it wasn't, you know, I didn't compete at Olympic Games, although at one stage I thought I should have won the Olympics, you know. I was that clear in my own mind that I was going to be a superstar, but known a wee bit that I should have known back then. I was never going to do that. I wasn't that good. But there was lots of analogies in sport and business and people.
And what are it's always a bit dangerous to try and sum up a whole philosophy about something that is your life simply, but you've mentioned one of the key things that you've learnt over the years being about being in the present and looking at what you can control.
Absolutely.
And goal setting. What else have you brought back with you into sport that you use now?
Yeah, it's probably that recognition of what's in front of you. You know, what are you actually working with? You know, so you can have all the manuals, you can have all the coaching books, you can all have all the coach education and philosophies and everything like that. But unless you actually understand what's in front of you, you know, so if I'm either working with a coach or working with an athlete or a group of athletes, is what's the here and now, what's actually going on at this moment. I think there's that understanding, the understanding of patience, and that, you know, the old cliche, Rome wasn't built in a day, you're not going to change it on a finger click. And taking time to do it and the understanding, but also, you know, having the markers associated with things. How do you know that it's working? How do you know what good is? How do you know that you're on the right track? So I would imagine, you know, all those things sort of interlinked. But most of all is that, what have you got in front of you? What is the problem? The recognizing the problem and the small steps associated with it. And again, you know, the cliche term of, you know, you can't eat an elephant in one sitting, but you'll get through the elephant if you take your time in small bites. And it's small bites and things. And, you know, one of the biggest things that I've learned is the patience of not trying to change everything overnight. And I think that's probably one of the things that I have brought to a lot of the work that I'm doing, is that it's understanding what you're working with, what the environment is, and then taking your time and how to change it.
And in terms of how that feeds into, for example, some of the difficult conversations you might have to have, whether it's with athletes or coaches, you sit down with someone and things aren't going right for them, they're not fulfilling the potential that they could have, and maybe you can see, you have a clear idea standing looking in from the outside what needs to change. But you have to lead the athlete to see that in a way that makes them want to change as well. How, I guess that comes back to patience, does it?
Back to patience, and it also comes back to honesty. But first, before you get to the honest bit, you have to have the trust. And the trust of the athlete or the coach. And sometimes that's hard earned. And sometimes that, you know, you can't go into a situation and just be... I'm pretty black and white and I'm pretty blunt, but... And that would be more in an environment that I know that, you know, that there's trust from both sides and people understand how I work. And you may have to take a little bit of time, and you do have to take an awful lot of time in developing that trust and developing that rapport with the person, and the understanding that, you know, you're here to help. You're not here to create a problem. You're not here to make a judgment. I don't, you know, I like to think that... you know, everybody's a little bit judgmental, I think, and what they do. But I like to try and quantify that and actually to be right, you know, to be pretty clear that there's always something going on behind the scenes. It's the reason why an individual will act in a certain way, and it's trying to understand all that. And then trying to trying to help the athlete and the coach understanding of the environment that they've created, and maybe it isn't being successful because of XYZ and XYZ. And it could be as simple as, you know, the emotional attachment between an athlete and a coach, or, you know, just blind spots around, you know, the technical end of things because they've always done it. Or sometimes it's, you know, just not knowing, or not knowing what good is. You know, what they think is good isn't really good. And that's where I like to be challenged as well. And some of the stuff that I do or we do or what we try to do is, you know, do we really understand what good is? Do we really understand if, you know, we may have some of these glorious programs, but do clubs want it, for example? Do athletes want it? Do the sport want it? Maybe not. It might be good in our world, but it mightn't be that good outside of it.
Sure. So you're always reassessing and just checking back in.
Yeah.
And that's, I guess, looking at how you would use some of these approaches on a one-to-one basis. How does that scale up if we look at, for example, the success that you had with the GB relay teams?
Yeah.
Is that just something that comes out of having all of these one-to-one conversations, or is there something else that you have to look at in terms of having an overall strategy and a larger scale approach to having a lot of athletes working together?
That's a really good question, and I think that's probably a huge big topic we could spend a long time on, and it's been all of those. It's individuals, it's been bringing individuals as part of a team, and I think it's trying to create a culture and environment that people are aware that, which is a wee bit unique in sprints, is that they're coming together mostly at the end of a competition after competing against each other and challenging each other for places and medals and everything like that, that they do have to come together as part of a team at the end of it. So it's, what does that culture look like? How do we manage that? How do we manage the individuals around that? That takes an awful lot of individual conversations. It takes an awful lot of patience and not an awful lot of understanding that some people, for example, in a relays, they see themselves very much as individuals, and it's hard for them to come as part of teams. But it's trying to create that environment with the peaks and the troughs of conversations that you try and get people to be as comfortable as they possibly can. And I think the way that, you know, that I and others and as part of the whole process have tried to do that, we've tried to take from our end, it's not about the personal end. I see myself as just the facilitator for a team coming together to represent Great Britain or to represent Scotland, if that's the, if it's a team environment there. But certainly you talk about relays, it's to represent the country, it's to represent Great Britain to the best that they can actually be. And it's for us to create that culture that they can all cohabitate in that things, even though you recognise their individual traits and the individual needs that they have. It's quite difficult.
And it's presumably something as well that we're talking very much about elite athletes, so
yeah,
kind of the top of the pyramid,
yeah,
if you like. But you don't get those elite athletes unless you've got the base of the pyramid, unless you've got,
yeah,
clubs really working well,
yeah,
together and developing athletes.
Yeah.
So perhaps taking those one at a time in terms of how clubs can best operate to get the best out of individuals but also create that kind of team ethos. What are the kind of things that you look for or you encourage clubs to,
yeah,
to try and think about?
Do you know, if I was really honest, which I try to be all the time, is that the club end of things is that where I'm learning and trying to understand what makes a really good club. And to make a really good club for me is that, you know, you have the governance really good, which I think Scottish Athletics do a great job in helping clubs understand what governance should be. But also, how do we recognise what coaches do in that setting, and how do coaches work, and how are they, you know, how are they able to facilitate the development of the club in that? I think that, you know, to me, what a really good coach in a club or a club coach, and again, this is coming back to, you know, the different elements in the pathway of the sport, is can one person coach wee Jimmy, who'll come into a club at 10, 12 years of age, and wee Jimmy has the talent to become an Olympic medalist. Can that one person bring him the whole way? Not now, I don't think. I think it's part of a team, it's part of a recognition that you need more, you need to bring in expertise at different levels, so you'll need to share and you'll need to, you know, bring people in. Like throughout my career, and still, you know, and I'll always go the way, I've always had people, you know, I would consider mentors or helping me or guides or someone that I can confide with and things like that. I think for too long, I think our education system and whatever, it probably tries to be too perfect that you can say that this person can do a level 2 course and then they've got equipped to coach wee Jimmy
to do everything. Yeah.
Can't do that. Modern sport, modern life, with all the struggles that we have. You know, Neil Black, for example, you know, the PD with British Athletics would wind me up at times to say that I use absolutely everyone in the GB system to ensure that the relays has success. How many more people do you want in your programme, Stephen, would be one of the things that he would say. And I think that's positive.
Yeah.
Because we develop good relationships with the biomech, we develop good relationships with the logistics, we develop good relationships with the personal coaches if they want to engage, we develop good relationships with the S&C coach and psychology and everything like that. So the team has to be big.
So it's about being open to
being
others'
open.
Expertise and not feeling challenged.
And it's recognising that, you know,
yeah,
that everybody, and this is where, you know, I have great admiration for the clubs in Scotland, which are much closer to the clubs in Scotland than anywhere else in my career, would be in, close isn't probably the right word, and understanding is probably a better word, whereas, you know, the amount of time that people invest into coaching for no remuneration, really, it's volunteers, and, you know, but I don't really like that word as well, because anybody who works at that is extremely professional and they do the right thing for the athletes, they just don't get paid for it.
Yeah.
And their remuneration is in a different way. It's the satisfaction of people growing and developing, and that's where I start coaching. I never thought I would end up in the position I was in, and, or that I'm in now, and everything like that. Somebody wants to pay me a good salary to do what I'm doing. I never thought that would be a career. But I have great admiration from everyone, and some of the greatest coaches. There's a guy at home called Terry McWilliams, who Terry was really only interested in fundamental movement and the development of probably athletes and sports people. He was a Gaelic games coach, and it was probably under 14s he was really interested in getting those skills right at that. But what a tremendous coach. Superb coach. And we have brilliant coaches that don't choose to be coaching at the elite end, or the elite end is something that challenges the life out of them, because that is tough. You know, the elite end of coaching, when you're in that, and I've been very fortunate in one way and scared out of my wits in another way, has been in that warm-up area with someone before they go into an Olympic final, and you're having to prepare them. And that person is the most vulnerable person in the world. Or you're with the relay teams who are going into Olympics or world finals, knowing that they have to absolutely trust each member of the team. They have to trust that, you know, myself and Benki and Christian at the time had our homework done, that, you know, our baton changing was right. Because that's how they were defined as athletes, and that if it's a men's relay team, 37 seconds for a 4x100 meters.
And there's a lot of work that goes into making those.
Hell of a lot of work.
Short
and there's a hell of a lot of work.
As
yeah, and there's a hell of a lot of work goes into the development of a Callum Hawkins, for example, or Laura Muir, and through her formative days. And
well, and in terms of getting those building blocks right, not just for people who go on to be elite athletes, but for people who just have
this
as a decent part of their life
for
many years.
Absolutely.
In terms of talking to some of our developing athletes, some of the younger athletes, what is the advice that you give to them in terms of approaching their sport?
Patience is the biggest one. Yeah. Patience and not trying to rush it. And, you know, I think it's great that people get recognised for early performance, but it's not great as well. You know, and at the end of the day, nobody really remembers someone who's the precocious 14, 15, 16-year-old, you know, is that, you know, it's one of the things people I used to laugh at when I went to, back in the day, to Irish Schools Championships. I kind of wouldn't really, I would admire what anybody who does it wins it, because it's always a hard title to win in our any national title. But you were kind of looking at the person who wasn't the early developer, someone who was going to come a little bit later, and seeing what talent they had. And, you know, and it's and even for the early developer, you never lose that talent. Sometimes when the others catch up with you, that's when you disappear and when you go away. But if they were to hang in there, they're going to get another spring forward, you know, because that talent isn't lost.
And it's a long game, whether you're going to be an Olympian
totally.
Or just a lifelong
Absolutely.
Decent club runner.
Absolutely.
Whatever.
And I think that's where coaching comes in. And I think that's where, you know, you talked to me about, you know, some of the serious conversations you would have with people is, you know, I think we have at Scottish Athletics, my job as performance and coaching lead is to have some of those honest conversations as well. You know, so some people put their whole life, for example, into being an elite athlete, and you kind of wonder, how are they going to earn a living? You know, how are they going to develop as people? And to me, I think we've got a massive duty to do that and to help people in that. So if you hit 24, 25, 26 and you've been an elite athlete, or you've been, for whatever, how you've done it, you've been able to survive, not having an education, not having a job, and you have this sort of superficial life where you train every day but you're not getting many results, I think it's part of our job as well is to put a wee bit of reality into people's careers and to lives. And that's the same with coaches. You know, coaching now is becoming more of a profession, and people are earning money outside of being involved with a governing body, and they're, you know, self-employed coaches, for example, and everything like that. But that's difficult. That's really, really hard. So, you know, I'm lucky that I've got a ton of experience, but could I set myself up as an elite sprints coach in Britain? I don't think you would make any money. I would love to be coaching every day, but we don't have the climate. Facilities, because of the climate, would be questionable. How can you, you know, sustain things? How can you get people to train every day? How can you make the money, you know? It's difficult. And you know, we've got some good examples of Andy Young, who's making it work, and he's doing a tremendous job with Laura, but I know the workload that Andy has, and he has to work extremely hard and extremely long hours, and probably with, he's lucky to get 2 weeks off in every year and things like that. So as a profession, it's a very difficult profession.
And I suppose it comes back to what we were talking about earlier, that this is, at the end of the day, this is part of an entire life. If your sport touches the edges of your life, if there's nothing else around the edges, it's not any good for you as a sports person, but also not any good for you as a human being.
Absolutely, and that's where the balance has to be right, doesn't it? You know, and it was just like me when I was that young athlete. You know, I the amount of training I did it manifest itself in an illness because of that? Probably not. But did it bring forward an illness? I would say absolutely. You know, there's something already going on, but I beasted my system. And we didn't really have anybody to tell us to slow down, you know, or to take a step back. And I think that's what we have to learn as well, is that you can push yourself to an extent where you do break. And that's a common term that we have in athletics, is, oh, you know, the athlete's broken or they're going to break or whatever. Is that if you can sustain training, sustain development and keep fun and enjoyment into things, at the end of the day, that's why you do it, then I think you'll get success at whatever choice that you have, at whatever level that you want to go to. But you don't push yourself to a level where your body breaks down completely and you're not able to recover.
Great. Well, I think we could talk forever about all these things more, but that sounds like a good point to leave it on. Thank you very much for talking to us today. Thanks, Stephen.
Thank you.